Good evening, friends. Long time actually. So last discussion was about approach to cough. So we can just call this as a continuation of that only. So cough with expectoration, it can be blood tinged. So when that happens, it's called as hemoptysis. And let's see how to approach when it comes to hemoptysis. So almost half of the discussion.
Good evening, friends.
This is the
long time actually. So last was.
So half of the approach when it comes to history and all, it will be the same as cough, as to how cough comes, onset, progression, like what we did the last time. So this remains the same. And when it comes to expectoration, so when the character and color, when it becomes blood tinged, we call it as hemoptysis, and we'll see how we'll go ahead from there. Okay. So let's begin, and as usual, we'll begin with the case. Okay. How do we proceed? It's the same like any other class. Introduction, we'll see how to deal with the history when a patient presents to us with hemoptysis. Very less about examination, investigations, and how do we approach. Okay, and we have two case scenarios. So we'll quickly finish the class as we have two classes today. So the first case, interesting case, it's about a 58-year-old gentleman who comes with complaints of cough, hemoptysis, and exertional dyspnea since the past 5 days. Okay, anyone willing to volunteer? So this is the chief complaint. Unmute Priyanka. Rishabh, there is one more case. So next case you volunteer, okay? Hello, Priyanka.
Yes, sir.
Yes, could you introduce yourself?
Sir, my name is Priyanka. I'm finally a medical student from Vaidehi, Bangalore.
Okay. Good evening, Priyanka. So
good evening, sir.
How do we approach this case? What do we do next? So imagine you are in your clinic and this happens. This is how a patient comes to you. These are the chief complaints.
So the history of presenting illness.
Yes. Okay. Before that, anything occupational or something you would like to ask?
Occupation.
In case it might not be significant, but patient details is important. And when it comes to cough, occupation history becomes important, as we had seen previously. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So next, we'll deal with HOPI. Okay. So HOPI, what you'd like to ask?
Cough and hemoptysis start at the same time, or was it there was a gap?
Cough and hemoptysis, it started at the same time.
Same time. Okay.
Yeah.
And okay.
Like, so, is there any structured method to ask for the history of cough?
So the onset and duration, progression.
Yes. So what all you'll ask for? Onset, duration. It's seen in the screen. No? Are you able to see?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. The frequency, variability. And this is how you go about it. And whether it's expectation, all these things you'll ask for. No. So let's come to our case now. Yeah. What all you'll ask for?
So the progression of the cough.
Progression of cough. Yeah, it has been gradually progressive.
Okay. Along with, is it associated with sputum, expectoration?
Expectoration, no, but yeah, it is associated with hemoptysis, blood tinged sputum.
Okay. Then any diurnal variation?
It's present throughout the day. On sleeping, it accentuates, but it's present throughout the day. Like whenever he sleeps, it accentuates.
Okay. And regarding the sputum, is it what is the color?
It is frank red color sputum.
Okay. And the quantity of the sputum?
It is around in a day around a cup, like around 25 to 100 ml comes.
Okay, sir. And the whether is it foul smelling?
No, it's not foul smelling.
Okay. Then is there any positional variation?
No, no position. That only on sleeping.
Okay. And then associated symptoms, sir. Is there any fever, night sweat, evening rise of temperature, chills?
Okay. The patient has been having mild grade fever. Okay.
Okay.
He's had night sweats also.
Okay.
Yeah. And he has had weight loss in the past 1 month of around 4 kgs.
Okay. So no other symptoms of any previous history of some respiratory tract infection or
what you'll ask for if you want to ask respiratory tract infection?
So like a post viral like post nasal drip or something like that with the respect to the
drip, how do you ask for post nasal drip? That comes like positional variation, if it's present, previous history of viral illness, all those things you'll ask for. No, that was not present.
Okay, sir. Based on this history, maybe it would be TB. So I would ask for any contact with TB.
Any contact with TB? No. As such, the patient did not have. He didn't have.
Okay. So, and since it's exertional dyspnea, so I would like to rule out a cardiac
that cause. That under associated symptoms, no? So associated symptoms, exertional dyspnea.
Okay. So is there any orthopnea and PND to rule out a cardiac cause?
No, orthopnea PND was not there.
Okay.
And this also started like recently, in these 5 days only. It was not present since before.
Okay. Any other palpitations or something, chest pain?
No, it was not present. No chest pain, no palpitation.
Okay.
So everyone is asking for swelling, orthopnea, fever, all these things are answered, I guess. Okay. In through the chat box to ask about history of RHD to rule out mitral stenosis. In the past history, there was no rheumatic heart disease present or did not suffer from rheumatic fever when she was a childhood. Okay, when it comes to past history, we'll think about that one.
Okay, abdominal and any past like malignancy because the patient has hemoptysis?
No, nothing as such. Okay, you're going into past history. Fine.
Yeah, past history.
No history of rheumatic fever. No history of malignancy. Anything else you want to ask?
Smoking, sir.
Okay, you're coming to personal history. Smoking person, he was a smoker, but he has quit from past 2 years.
Okay.
He's been smoking for 30 years, then he's quit from past 2 years, he's quit. Someone is asking for voice change. No voice change.
Okay.
Yeah. So anything else you would ask for? Difficulty swallowing, all these things, good. You're all thinking towards malignancy. So in associated symptoms, no change in voice, no hoarseness, no difficulty in swallowing was present. Undergone any past treatment history, any surgical procedure or something he had undergone? No, he did not undergo that.
Okay. Any trauma?
Good, very good question. No, there was no trauma.
Okay.
So PI over, past history over, family history, if you want to ask, you can ask.
Again, any malignancies in the family?
No, it was not there. Anything else you want to ask in past history, you can ask. Associated symptoms, you can ask. Or if you are done asking, you can tell your DDs.
Okay, DD, the first one would be tuberculosis.
Okay, why do you say so? Bleeding disorders in the family,
yeah,
very good.
Bleeding disorders, yeah.
There was no bleeding disorders in the family, no coagulopathy, okay? Any issue of tooth infection, correct, good. His Shavan is going in terms of infective endocarditis. She was not immunocompromised, he was not immunocompromised also. There was no history of tooth infection also, Shavan.
Okay.
Yes, Priyanka, first you want to think of TB, okay? In Indian scenario, TB is the most common cause for hemoptysis. Agreed. Next.
It can be because of
Would you like to confirm whether it's hemoptysis or hematemesis?
Yes, sir.
So first you'll look into the source of bleeding, no? So for that, did you confirm in your history anything? He coughs out blood is the one thing you told. So it was preceded by cough. Anything else you'll...
So is there nausea and vomiting? Vomiting.
No nausea and vomiting preceding the event.
Okay. Yeah, and then the color, sir. Okay, is it bright red or is it dark?
This was bright red in color, yes.
Okay, so that is hemoptysis.
There was no associated myelina, Sharanya.
Okay.
So with these questions, you are confirming that it is hemoptysis. Could content, there was no food particle contained in it. Okay. So all these questions, we'll see what all questions. Yes, frothy in nature, good.
Yeah.
Kunj, all these things you'll ask for. So, okay, TB is on top of your head. Anything else you would like to consider, Priyanka?
So, it could be bronchiectasis.
Yes, bronchiectasis. But bronchiectasis comes about copious amount of sputum. This year, hardly any sputum production is there.
Okay.
You can take bronchitis, but bronchitis also there'll be copious amount of sputum, but then acute bronchitis picture you can have.
Okay.
Chronic, because this has come only with 5-day history, no? Okay, malignancy is in the head.
Malignancy
in the head. Okay. Anything else?
So is there any history?
Causes. There are serious causes.
Causes.
Anything
and then can be vasculitis.
Okay, you want to think of vasculitis. Okay, good.
Okay.
Vasculitis. For that, you should have asked, you want to ask for any other symptoms in case of vasculitis, any renal related symptoms? Vasculitis comes with a broad picture, no?
Decreased urine output.
Yes, so it can involve RS, it can involve RS, it can involve cardiac, pericarditis, so all it can involve, along with fever, myalgia, skin rash, all those things you will have to ask for, no? So
yes,
those things you should have asked in your associated symptoms, but this patient as such did not have any of them. Okay. So vasculitis I have included in the DD.
Then it can be a bronchogenic carcinoma. Okay.
So malignancy, yes. Have put that also.
Then could it be a lung abscess, sir?
Lung abscess, it is not foul smelling, and he did not have lung abscess. Will come with high grade fever.
Yeah.
This was just a mild grade continuous fever. Okay, lung abscess you want to think in terms of. Good. And there will be positional variation also.
Yeah.
Like variation not while sleeping, but once you move from one position to other, it would have accentuated. Correct, no?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Sonakshi tells, considering the age of the patient, pulmonary embolism we'll have to consider. Good.
Mm.
Even that can come like this.
Sir, and also in any bleeding disorder, so in the family history, I would like to ask for that.
Yeah, that already we have asked. It was not present. Okay. So, can we move ahead?
Yes, sir.
So, you'll go to examination. Examination, when it comes to hemoptysis, would you like to see the vitals for any purpose?
Sir, pallor. Pallor. There will be pallor. And
Shravan, asking that question. Shravan, it was just ED, okay? And there might be any chronic condition which has led to pulmonary embolism now. Yeah. So, yeah, continue, Priyanka.
Sir, I would look for pallor because there is...
Before all those things, something very important when it comes to vitals.
Pulse.
Yes, because why? Why you want to look at the vitals?
So there will be tachycardia because there is
you
gives
want
an
to rule out a shock, no?
Yeah.
Hemoptysis patient, yeah. So pulse rate, there was no tachycardia, around 88 beats per minute was there.
Okay.
BP was 160 by 90 mmHg.
Okay.
Temperature was 100 degree Fahrenheit.
Okay.
Anything else you want? Respiratory rate was around 28 cycles per minute. Next, you want head-to-toe examination, no?
Yes, sir.
So, in that, you'll ask for, what all you'll ask for?
Head-to-toe first.
What all you'll look for? You'll look for something. First is your pickle, correct?
Yeah, pickle.
Yes. So pallor was present in this patient. Anything else?
Because it can cause like hypoxic theory of clubbing.
Yes, so, good. So lung abscess, bronchogenic carcinoma, all these things can come with clubbing. Any AV malformation, if it's present, that is leading to this, correct, no?
Yes, sir.
Yes, correct. So cyanosis, yes, you can ask again if the patient is going into respiratory failure. As of now, no.
And edema also to rule out any failure, left side or congestive heart failure.
Edema was not there. And lymphadenopathy, is that important?
So if you think, we're thinking of any infectious etiology, like maybe a lung abscess, and TB,
becomes important. Yeah, and even secondaries can come like this. So other sites also becomes important. Axillary lymph node, supraclavicular, all those things. Huh? Okay, inguinal, all those things become important. Okay, so nothing as such you got over here. Pallor was present. Okay, BP was high. Okay, this much you got to know. Next.
So the RS examination, respiratory system examination.
Yes, RS, there was bilateral Krebs heard in this patient.
Okay, Krebs.
Krebs was heard in this patient. Almost 30 minutes. Quick.
Was it in the basal or was it like basal?
It was diffuse. It was not basal.
Okay.
Systemic examination did not reveal anything. So with this, any differential diagnosis you can make?
Maybe it could be chronic bronchitis.
Okay, you are thinking of chronic bronchitis. Fine. Still, TB will still be on top
TB,
of the list.
Yeah,
we are thinking of chronic bronchitis. Okay.
TB.
Still malignancy, you can consider pulmonary embolism. All these things you can still consider.
Pneumonia.
Next, you'll move to investigation. So, what you would like to do? Which investigation?
So, CBC, complete blood count.
So, you want to do CBC in this patient.
Yes,
okay.
Yes,
CBC, there was anemia was present. Okay.
Okay.
Anemia was present. Then blood count was okay. Fine. Total blood count was okay.
Okay.
Then total count was around 14,000 with lymphocyte predominant, 85%. Okay. This side.
Okay. So chest X-ray.
Yes, good. So next you'll go to imaging modality, chest X-ray. So in this patient, this was his chest X-ray.
So the this is a plain X-ray, and the bronchovascular markings are clearly seen. Like you cannot
There's bilateral pulmonary infiltrate present, no?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Yes, good. Okay.
And there's also like the opacities. I don't know.
Bilateral pulmonary opacification is present.
Opacification. Mostly the bilaterally. That's it.
Okay. Next.
And there's tracheal deviation.
CT scan also reveal the same.
Okay.
Bilateral opacification was present.
Okay.
So someone came up with the diagnosis. Ravish, very good. This is almost with the history. It is characteristic of diffuse alveolar hemorrhage.
Oh.
Correct, no?
Yes, sir.
So with this diffuse alveolar hemorrhage, okay, and his BP being high, along with pallor, would you like to, what next investigation you would like to consider? Bronchoscopy also revealed that. Bronchoscopy revealed multiple alveoli filled with hemorrhage. Someone tells it's RFT.
Okay.
On doing RFT, creatinine was increased. Okay. Then they did urine routine. Urine routine showed proteinuria was present. Okay. And there was RBCs. Okay. RBCs was present.
Okay.
Okay. So microscopic hematuria was present in this case. Now, what you like to think? Methyluria with proteinuria, serum creatinine raised, all these things happening in a short amount of time with.
So, is it some there is some vasculitis?
Yes,
it's affecting all the.
Okay. So next, what you'll, which is the screening test you do, if it is you're thinking of vasculitis?
Yeah, that anti-nucleus, ANCA. Yes.
Okay, ANCA. ANCA showed P ANCA was positive in this case.
Okay.
P ANCA was positive. On doing kidney biopsy, they revealed RPGN picture was there. Crescents were present. Mm-hmm. Now, would you like to come up with diagnosis? A diffuse alveolar hemorrhage with RPGN picture with P ANCA positive. What is it?
Good pastures.
No, good pastures. Basement membrane antibody would have been positive. If you want to come, you can look at the chat box. It was a case of microscopic polyangiitis. Okay.
Okay. Yes.
Good, Priyanka.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
So let's start. Let's start with the definition. So what is hemoptysis? Firstly, hemoptysis is nothing but expectoration of blood or blood thin sputum of any amount from the respiratory tract. That is important. Important to localize the site. Okay, because it can either be from nasopharynx or it can be from the upper respiratory tract like nasopharynx, or it can be from our GIT. So is it okay? So arising from the respiratory tract, okay, from alveoli to glottis, any location. So differential diagnosis, as mentioned, it can be epistaxis or hematemesis. This arises from nasopharynx, this arises from upper GIT. So next, from where does this arise? From where does this hemoptysis arise? So that is important to look into. For that, we'll come into blood supply. And we know it is dual blood supply. So one is by pulmonary arteries. Second one is by bronchial arteries. So which is more prone in most of the cases? From where does it come from? Which is the most common site among these two for it to bleed? Yes, around 90% of the times it is bronchial arteries. So which is a source of hemoptysis? 90% of the time it is bronchial arteries. 5% of the times some other non-bronchial systemic arteries, which some minor arteries, arterial supply, which comes from there. And rest 5% of the time it is from pulmonary artery. Like in our case, it was because of bleed from pulmonary capillaries, which led to diffuse alveolar hemorrhage. Okay. So what could be the cause? Why such high predilection in the bronchial artery? What could have been the cause? Anyone? Yes, high pressure. One of the main important is good Rishabh. It is because of high pressure. Okay, so one, because it is thin and more fragile walls will be present. Two, systemic pressure load will as it is be high. So since bronchial artery arises from the aorta directly, systemic pressure is high. So it is much more prone. Next one is opening of arteries into chronically inflamed zones. Like in case of bronchitis, bronchiectasis, and all these arteries directly open into there. So bronchial artery directly supply over there. So it gets chronically inflamed, erosed, and hemoptysis takes place. And finally, rupture and hemorrhages of the airway. Whenever there is airway predilection, since because of its supply over there, it is more prone. So these are the reasons why bronchial artery is most common cause and most common site for the bleed. So next, coming to the causes. Okay, so in the causes, most common is infectious. So single most common cause, if they ask if the question has bronchitis, then go for it. Okay, if not, if the question has TB, then go for TB. Okay, as a single entity, tuberculosis is the most common cause. And when we take a broader picture into account, bronchitis is the most common cause. Okay, so tuberculosis being the most common cause worldwide. So if it comes for MCQ, read it properly. Then it can have bronchiectasis, pneumonia, fungal infection like aspergillosis and all. What is the cause for endemic hemoptysis? Anyone? Endemic hemoptysis is caused by which parasite? Yes, Ravish, Paragonimus. Full name? Yes, Paragonimus westermanni. Okay. pseudohemoptysis is caused by two very favorite question, entrance exam question. Yes, serratia macerans. What is the cause? What is the pigment that is present that causes this pseudo? Yes, very good. It is protogeosin. Protogeosin. Okay. Next comes the pulmonary. What are the other pulmonary causes? So it can be bronchitis. It can be cystic fibrosis. It can be because of vasculitis, which affects vasculitis affecting the pulmonary capillaries, like granulomatosis with polyangiitis, Wegener's, microscopic polyangiitis, Behçet's, Goodpasture syndrome, or it can be because of direct airway injury. Okay, airway injury because of toxic chemicals, thermal injury, or secondary to intubation or any other procedures that is being carried out, or it can be because of malignancies. Okay, it can be bronchogenic lung carcinoma, carcinoid tumors. This presents with flushing and all carcinoid symptoms. Then comes any metastatic disease from other solid organ malignancy, metastasizing over here. But instance of this is very rare though. Next comes, like, you in the sense, this presenting as hemoptysis is very rare, a metastatic disease. Okay. Then comes collagen vascular cardiovascular disorders. Even collagen vascular disorders like SLE also can present. SLE, all those things can also present. And yeah, these are surgical entities. Bronchial cyst, sequestration of lung, intralobular, extralobular, all those things also can present. Okay. Finally, there can be cardiovascular cause. One is pulmonary AV malformation. Second is pulmonary embolism, pulmonary arterial hypertension. Then comes mitral stenosis, congestive heart failure, mitral regurgitation, aneurysm. Why in case of mitral regurgitation we'll have? It is because of the regurgitant jet of blood, which will increase the pressure. Okay. And in case of mitral stenosis, is do we find hemoptysis? Anyone? Can you guys answer through your chat? Or it can be because of any bleeding disorder, coagulopathy, or thrombocytopenia. It can be iatrogenic, secondary to procedure, or any drug induced, secondary to taking anticoagulants, you can end up having. And there is this entity already discussed, diffuse alveolar hemorrhage, wherein the pulmonary capillaries bleed into the alveoli. So this can either be because of one inflammatory cause. Second one is because of non-inflammatory causes. Okay, so non-inflammatory, all these causes already discussed, like any airway injury becomes non-inflammatory causes, and inflammatory causes will be any collagen vascular disorders or something like vasculitis, or it can be because of Goodpasture syndrome, wherein the pulmonary capillaries bleed and there will be alveolar hemorrhage. Okay, diffuse alveolar hemorrhage. So this was to do with the introduction and the causes of hemoptysis. So next, coming to history. So what is the first thing we would like to do? We like to confirm the source of bleeding. So it can either be hemoptysis or hematemesis. So hemoptysis, it will be preceded by tingling of the throat or chest, or it can be preceded by the cough. Over here, it will be preceded by nausea or vomiting. Next, it will come with frothy sputum. There will be no frothy secretion in case of hematemesis. And this is slightly alkaline in nature, but this, since it's coming from gastric secretion, it is acidic in nature. Okay, next comes blood thin sputum persists for few days, but this will just be an episode and nothing comes after that on coughing in case of hematemesis. Next, it is mixed with macrophages and neutrophils. Over here, it is mixed with food particles, as you guys already told. Melina may be present in case of hematemesis, but absent in case of hemoptysis. Color, very important. This will be bright red in color. This will be dark brown in color due to conversion into hematin. Next, previous history of respiratory disease will be present over here. Over here, previous history of gastric or liver disease can be present. So it can either like something like peptic ulcer disease or because of portal gastropathy, anything related to liver, it would have caused varices, variceal bleed can take place. Next, symptoms of significant blood clots is more common when it comes to hematemesis as compared to hemoptysis. And asphyxia can be caused when it comes to hemoptysis, but very uncommon with hematemesis. So these are the things that we differentiate. Very important viva question for you people. Okay. Next, coming to the amount of sputum, we'll have to ask the amount of sputum. And this values is given different in different books. Okay. Mild or scant. moderate is around from 20 to 200 ml per day. Next is massive or severe. Massive or severe will be greater than 200 to 600 ml per day. Or it can be any life-threatening hemoptysis. Any life-threatening hemoptysis will be massive. Okay. So consider this in amount of sputum. Next, come to the associated symptoms. Okay. But again, telling these values, each textbook gives each thing. So not that sure as to what to take. But Harrison said this, so I've taken this from Harrison. So this is greater than 200 to 600 ml or any life-threatening hemoptysis. This is up to 200 ml and this is less than 20 ml in a day. So this will come around a cup. This is around a tablespoon. Okay. So this will be your next important Viva question. Okay. Following this is the associated symptoms which you will look for. This you can look in terms of infective causes, respiratory causes, cardiovascular causes, and iatrogenic induced. So whatever we have discussed till now, is associated with chronic cough, weight loss, evening rise of temperature, if there is TB contact, if there is immunocompromised state, mild to moderate hemoptysis, we can think of TB. Or if the same patient presents with massive hemoptysis, then we can either think of TB or even aspergilloma also presents this way. So what is the cause in this case for massive hemoptysis? Anyone? Massive hemoptysis in case of tuberculosis. What is the cause? Again, favorite Viva question. Yes, the aneurysm. Yes, rupture of Rasmussen aneurysm. Okay. Next comes bronchiectasis. So bronchiectasis, the patient produces copious amount of sputum when it comes to bronchiectasis. As we read in our last class, it produces very large amount of sputum when it comes to bronchiectasis, along with positional variation, history of chronic cough, history of repeated infections. All those things will be there in case of bronchiectasis. Then if it is pneumonia, then patient presents with high grade fever. Presentation will vary. High grade fever, cough, blood-tinged sputum, chills, rigors, all those things will be present. Okay. This along with foul smelling sputum, all those things along with positional variation, then we can think of lung abscess. Okay. Next comes bronchitis. Bronchitis, again, it can either be an acute presentation or chronic presentation, secondary to infection or allergic. So chronic or acute cough, mild to moderate sputum, okay? Or it can come with copious amount of sputum production, anything. Mild to moderate hemoptysis, okay? So all these things can be presenting feature. So next is a patient with background history of chronic bronchitis, if that patient comes with sudden onset of hemoptysis, then we'll think of bacterial superinfection. So three most common organisms being streptococcal pneumonia, H. influenza, varicella catarrhalis. Okay. This is the same with cystic fibrosis as well. So, and cystic fibrosis patient, what happens is he'll be having a history of chronic cough for 20 to 25 years. Suddenly he'll come with massive hemoptysis. So this is one of the life-threatening complications when it comes to cystic fibrosis patient. He can come with chronic cough, mild to moderate hemoptysis. That also can be a presentation. But at the end stage, he can have sudden life-threatening complication of massive hemoptysis. So that as well can happen in a patient of cystic fibrosis. Next comes the airway inhalation. In that, what history can we have? Inhalation of toxic chemicals, inhalants, thermal injury, cocaine, so drug abuse, any procedure if he has undergone. All these things will be present when it comes to airway injury. Next can be malignancy. In case of malignancy, what are the risk factors? One is age greater than 40 years. Second is smoking. So these two, if these two risk factors are present, then we can consider malignancy. What are the other features? Cough, hoarseness, weight loss, night sweats, all these things can be present. Okay. Next comes any collagen vascular disorder. So in this case, cough will be there, fever will be there, arthralgia will be there, dyspnea will be there, any skin rashes will be there. So if these features are present, we'll think in terms of SLE or other collagen vascular disorders. Next comes vasculitis, as we saw in our case. Our case was an acute onset, but it can come either with acute onset or with the background history of like fever, myalgia, arthralgia, those inflammatory symptoms can be present. So hematuria can be present, sinusitis, otitis, fever, arthralgia, skin lesion, ulcers, all these things, if they are present, we can think in terms of vasculitis. So these two are multi-organ presentation. When it comes to multi-organ presentations, then we can think of vasculitis or any collagen vascular disorders. Next comes pulmonary embolism, coming to serious causes. Pulmonary embolism or infarct, acute onset chest pain, sudden dyspnea, all those things. And with pulmonary embolism can as well mimic, we come with no symptoms, just cough and hemoptysis as well. No associated symptoms also can be there. So in that condition, you'll have to think any surgical history present, if the patient is on any anticoagulants, if the patient is immobilized for a long time, all those things, history will help you in diagnosing. Okay. And next comes congestive heart failure. So symptoms of cough, pink frothy sputum, especially when it comes to CHF. Okay, dyspnea, chest pain, raised JVP, heart failure symptoms, orthopnea, PND, all those things you can ask for. Finally, comes to mitral stenosis. Over here, you'll have exertional dyspnea. Okay, if past history of RHD can be there, then on exertional, you'll be on exertion, then you'll get cough, which is associated with hemoptysis. All those things can be there when it comes to mitral stenosis. Okay, now once associated symptoms is done, this then comes past medical history. Past medical history, you guys almost covered everything when we were dealing with our first case, like TB, malignancy, past history of DVT, pulmonary embolism, or CVS disorder. These people will be put on anticoagulants. So they are prone for hemoptysis or hematemesis. Then any history of surgery, immobilization, all those things, they are prone to pulmonary embolism. Then comes chronic liver disease. They can lead to coagulopathy or thrombocytopenia, which will lead to bleed. Next comes history of renal disease. If this is present, then we can think in terms of ANCA-associated vasculitis, Goodpasture syndrome, SLE, all those things. If the patient is immunocompromised, like HIV, transplant, or any other immunocompromised state, they are prone to infections. That will lead to hemoptysis or any bleeding tendencies if it's present from his past history or in case of family history. That becomes important. Same thing, rheumatological disorder, vasculitis, bleeding disorder, TB, whichever is associated with family, that becomes important in family history. Drugs, again, anticoagulants can be one of the cause. Next, coming to personal history, IV drug abusers, you should ask for infective endocarditis or any drug abuse like cocaine, snorting can cause it. Occupational exposure becomes important. So this was to do with the history. Next, after history, physical examination, main thing when it comes to hemoptysis, what we are concerned is patient shouldn't be in shock. So patient shouldn't collapse over there. For that purpose, first thing we'll check for vital signs, followed by oxygen saturation. You guys missed out oxygen saturation in the previous history. Whether there is evidence of any life-threatening bleed. So this thing we'll have to consider first. Okay. So if there's tachycardia, hypotension, and decreased oxygen saturation, then the approach becomes different. The patient will be admitted directly to ICU and managed over there. Okay. So the approach becomes different. Two extreme approaches present. So main thing is to look for vital signs and O2 saturation. Okay. Next, we'll do a routine head-to-toe assessment, systemic assessment. Okay. So thorough systemic and head-to-toe assessment is necessary. So like you can pick up clubbing, you can rule out, you can come to a narrow diagnosis. If you pick up lymphadenopathy, if you pick up edema, all those things, you can narrow down your diagnosis. Okay, so that will help you. And again, signs of chronic liver disease, again, that will help to narrow down the diagnosis. So this was to do with our history and examination. So what are the set of investigations that is important for our case? A case of hemoptysis means chest x-ray. Routine chest x-ray is important, CT scan is important. Then lab studies, coming to lab studies, CBC, coagulation studies, ESR, because TB can be raised in Indian setting, RFT can be done, urine analysis, and ABG. So these things become important. Finally, sputum analysis as well is important. If all these investigations are unrevealing, then we can go ahead and do a bronchoscopy. Okay, so these were the basic investigations that we'll do. So keeping this in mind, let's see how to approach a case of hemoptysis. So we'll see if take a few questions. Which is the first test to be done in case of hemoptysis? This is your entrance exam question as well. So yes, futile CBC, futile chest x-ray. It is chest x-ray. This is the initial investigation to be done in a case of hemoptysis. Okay, so in the chart which you see, it is given in Harrison as well. Chest X-ray is the first investigation to be done. Okay, so this is your entrance exam question as well. Okay, so next question goes like this: a patient presents to casualty with massive hemoptysis. Okay, so bedside X-ray was done. And it was unrevealing. He could not make any site of infection also, site of bleed also, not could he come to any diagnosis. So what is the next test to be done in this patient? He comes with massive hemoptysis. So all are telling B, bronchoscopy, good. So now I'll change this question and make it moderate hemoptysis. Mild to moderate hemoptysis. There are no any life-threatening symptoms. Now what do you do? Few are telling still B and many are telling A. Good. In that case, it will become CT scan. Because bedside CT scan, don't think so, it is available everywhere. So that is why bedside CT scan cannot be done. In case of massive hemoptysis, we'll go and do a bronchoscopy. Okay. Yes, Sonakshi, bedside bronchoscopy can be done. Bedside CT cannot be done. That's why we do bedside bronchoscopy. Okay. That is why in case of massive hemoptysis, since we are managing the patient in ICU, we'll do bronchoscopy followed by chest X-ray. Okay. Next question. A patient presents with moderate hemoptysis. Therapeutic bronchoscopy was done, but the bleed did not stop. Okay. So what is the next line of management? Okay, balloon tamponade can be done. That is why I mentioned therapeutic bronchoscopy was tried, but it did not stop. Yes, very good. Ravish came up with the correct answer. Then they go ahead and try bronchial artery embolization. Okay, so this is the next modality. So since you people are very much aware of the flowchart, we'll just see how to approach. Just a revision for you guys now, it will be. So a case of hemoptysis comes to you. What do you do? First is, through our history, we confirm whether it is hemoptysis or not. So we'll rule out other sites. We'll rule out oropharynx like epistaxis or hematemesis to be the cause. Once we rule out that, we'll go consider the amount of hemoptysis. Why is this important for us? Because the patient shouldn't be in shock, or the patient shouldn't go to shock. So next, what we'll do, we'll monitor the vital parameters, we'll go check the saturation and give oxygen if needed. And if the site of bleeding is known, like if we know that the patient is suffering from TB, he has his right side of the lung is involved, he is a patient of TB who has come down, then we'll put him on right side. Okay, so that the other lung also, the bleed doesn't go into the other lung remains clear. So bleeding side down if the site is numb, and the patient can be put on sedation or anxiolytic if he's having massive hemoptysis. Okay, next, if these are present, tachycardia, hypotension, or decrease in oxygen saturation is present, then we'll consider the bleed to be a life-threatening bleed. So that becomes massive hemoptysis. If this is not present, then we'll consider mild to moderate hemoptysis. Okay, if this is there, then we do a thorough history taking and physical examination followed by chest X-ray. Chest X-ray becomes first. Okay. If it is a case of mild hemoptysis, like around a teaspoon of blood is found throughout the day, some small amount of blood in sputum comes, most of the time the etiology is an infection. Okay. So if there are no risk factors present, like smoking or age greater than 40 years, we treat the underlying cause, because most of the time the underlying condition will be infection. The patient will resolve with the conservative management. If risk factor is present, like smoking since a long time or age is greater than 40 years along with smoking, then we do a CT scan. Or if the patient comes with recurrent bleed, even then we go ahead and do a CT scan. Okay, in that patient, even if that CT scan is not able to diagnose, only then we go ahead and do a bronchoscopy. Okay, with bronchoscopy, if the underlying cause is found, we go ahead and treat the underlying cause. Okay, so this is to do with mild hemoptysis. If it is moderate hemoptysis, then we can consider other investigations also along with chest x-ray, like CBC, coagulation profile, urine analysis, RFP, sputum analysis, CBNAT, all those things we can consider. If until now the cause is not made out, then we go ahead again and do CT scan. So first modality is chest x-ray, second one is CT scan, higher order investigation. So like we saw in our previous question, if even the CT scan is not revealing, we go ahead and do a diagnostic bronchoscopy. Okay, by doing diagnostic bronchoscopy only, if we are able to stop the bleed, like if we can just by putting cold saline or tamponade, if you are able to stop the bleed, then we can go ahead and do a therapeutic bronchoscopy also. So by doing this, we treat the underlying disease. If the bleeding still persists, then we go ahead and do a bronchial artery embolization. So that was the question. That was the question over there. Okay. So this was to do with mild and moderate. Next comes massive hemoptysis. So when it comes to massive hemoptysis, then we'll have to activate the ACLS team. So CAB, the CPR, which we had done in our previous session, that becomes important. So since there is so much hemoptysis, we'll have to secure airway and we'll have to intubate the patient. Okay, that becomes more important when it comes to massive hemoptysis. So that becomes our first line of management. Rather than knowing the etiology, stopping the bleed and resuscitating the patient becomes our first line. So admit to ICU, activate ACLS team and intubate the patient. Okay, and if we can put the bleeding site down, if the site of bleed is known to us and volume resuscitation is done. Once the CAB is taken care of, okay, next we'll go and do a bedside chest x-ray. So if the bedside chest x-ray is followed by a bedside bronchoscopy, okay, so these are the two tests we do. After this, if the bleeding is localized, then well and good, we can go ahead and do a bronchoscopic management. So what all can we do? We can just put cold saline and wait, or we can do a balloon tamponade, or we can put a stent over there, or we can do ablative methods, thermal ablative methods. So even after this, if it is the bleeding is still not stopped, then we go ahead and do embolization. Okay, even after this the bleeding is not stopped, final modality is surgery. We'll have to consider surgery to be the treatment. Okay, like in our first case, what we saw, no, over there, what could have been the treatment? Over there, we couldn't have done bronchial artery embolization. How do you think that patient improved? Bronchoscopic management, I don't think so, it would have helped. It is a case of diffuse alveolar hemorrhage. And it was almost emergency also because the patient had pallor also. Yes, pulse therapy with maybe methylprednisolone will help in those cases, okay? In that case, steroid, good lymphocyte, small lymphocyte is your name. Okay, fine. So, okay, bleeding site is localized, well and good, bronchoscopic management can be done. If the bleeding site is not localized, then you can go ahead and take the patient for a CT scan, okay? So, through CT scan, if the etiology is like something like pulmonary artery rupture or aspergilloma refractory to bronchial artery embolization or chest trauma, we'll directly consider surgery. If it is other etiologies, then we'll go ahead and do bronchial artery embolization, okay? Even after doing multiple attempts of bronchial arterial embolization, if it still recurs, then again we can consider surgery, okay? If no etiology is made out, then we go ahead, do a close follow-up, try to do conservative management, try this and attempt to stop the bleed. So this was the approach in brief. So what is the question asked for us in our entrance exam? Mostly, which is the first modality, that is chest x-ray. Second one following chest x-ray is CT scan. Therapeutically, what is the first thing we do? We try to manage through bronchoscopy. If not, bronchoscopy is followed by bronchial artery embolization. That is followed by surgery. So remember that order. One order of investigation, chest x-ray followed by CT followed by bronchoscopy. If it is massive, chest x-ray followed by bronchoscopy followed by CT. If when it comes to treatment, first is bronchoscopic management, if not bronchial artery embolization, if not surgery, okay? So they can mix and match and confuse you in your MCQs, okay? So that's it. So let's take up our final case then. So a 54-year-old man presents with chronic productive cough and hemoptysis since 2 months. Anyone? would like to volunteer, please raise your hand. Quick, we have one more class coming up, that's why. Yes, Rishabh had raised his hand. Rishabh, you can unmute yourself.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir, Rishabh. Can we go ahead with the case?
Yes, sir. So we'll occupation, sir.
So occupational history, he was a driver. Okay.
Okay, sir. Take history of presenting illness.
Okay, HOPI.
Oh, again now, onset, progression, frequency of the cough.
You'll cough since onset, progression. It will be a revision of previous and this class, okay? Onset, progression, frequency and variability. What else you'll ask when it comes to cough?
Sputum, the consistency.
Okay, whether it is associated with expectoration, okay? Okay, it's better we go to that slide only. Okay, these are the things. So onset of the cough you will ask for. Onset, usually you shouldn't comment on only when we suspect any foreign body, abrupt onset we talk of. Or else when it comes to cough and fever, better not to comment about onset. Next comes the duration of cough. In this case, it's been present. Since 2 months, he's been having cough. Okay?
Yes.
Yeah, next.
Any positional variations?
So that becomes a case of chronic cough. If you guys remember from our previous class, any positional variation in this patient, positional variation was not present. Okay.
Okay.
And there was no variability in the day also. It was just chronic continuous cough.
Okay. Associated with sputum.
Yes, it was a productive. Expectation. You came here. It was a case of productive cough. What you'd like to ask now?
The amount, color.
Moderate amount of sputum was present.
The color, consistency.
Color, it was mucopurulent. Okay, mucopurulent. Character and color is done. Along with blood tinged.
Any foul smelling?
Any?
Foul smelling?
No, it was not foul smelling. And there was no positional variation. And there was no presence of foreign bodies. Okay? Next, anything else you want to ask? You asked no precipitating and delivering factors were present. It was almost the same since 1 month. So there's no change in frequency with time. Only associated symptoms you're left out with.
Fever, sir.
Huh?
Fever, sir.
Fever was not present in this case. No fever was there.
Any weight loss?
Okay. Weight loss also not present.
Any chest pains?
Chest pain. Okay, fine. To make it easier, we'll make it as this patient, okay, from past 1 month, he's been having low-grade fever, He's been having low-grade fever, night sweats he's been having, okay? Next, what did you ask for? Weight loss, no?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, weight loss is also present, okay? Around 5 to 6 kgs in the last 3 months.
Oh, any history of contact with TB, sir?
No history of contact with TB.
Okay. Any edema, palpitations?
Okay, you're ruling out CVS causes. Good, that was not present.
Any rashes, arthralgia?
Good, very good. No, that was also not present.
Any history of procedures?
History of procedure, no iatrogenically induced this thing.
Any breathlessness?
Shravan, very good. Shravan is asking for past history of TB. He was diagnosed with TB when he was 50 years of age. Okay. And he was treated also successfully. He was treated for the TB also.
Okay. Any other medical histories? Like bleeding any disorders?
Medical history, no. He's remaining, he's been healthy since then.
Okay.
There's no history of trauma. Anything else, Rishabh?
So smoking?
Smoking, no. No history of smoking. personal history. Okay. No history of smoking, no history of illicit drug abuse, all those things are not present.
Okay.
Is this any differential diagnosis?
Tuberculosis.
Hmm?
Tuberculosis.
Since considering it can be a relapse case of tuberculosis, very good. Yes, tuberculosis on top of the head.
Then bronchogenic carcinoma.
Bronchogenic malignancy. Okay, fine. Always consider malignancy in the end. Okay, fine. It's a chronic.
Bronchiectasis.
Okay, what if I tell he was a smoker? Now we can increase our differential diagnosis. Okay. He's been a smoker since past 30 years. Abdominal pain for intestinal TB. No, it was not present. No abdominal pain, no melina, nothing was present.
Bronchiectasis.
Chronic bronchitis we can include. No, if since he's a smoker, COPD, chronic bronchitis, all those things will come. No, that, okay, fine. That you are including now. Chronic bronchitis, we are including. Next. Anything else you would like to consider? Pneumonia is not been having high grade fever, all those things, no? Okay, Shravan tells it is aspergilloma. Okay, good. This also we can consider because both TB and aspergilloma can come the same way. It can mimic each other, no?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so pulmonary aspergillosis we can consider. Next. Anything else?
So does he have any renal problems?
Okay, good. No, that is not present. No chest pain, Sonakshi. So with this differential diagnosis in mind, can we move ahead to examination?
Yes, sir.
Oh, okay, fine. We'll go to examination. So on examination, there was some amount of ronchi was heard in right upper lobe. That's all. Not ronchi, sorry. Krebs was present. End inspiratory Krebs was present in right upper lobe.
Okay.
That's all. Nothing else was present.
Maybe cavities of the TB.
Okay. So you're thinking of cavitation of the TB that has led to secondary infection. Okay. So now that has added on to your differential diagnosis. Correct, no?
Yes, sir.
Yes, good. So if cavity is present, any other examination finding you will expect? What is the type of breathing you will have? Any
egophony.
Yes, all those things. Just know all those things. Okay. I can't go into that in detail since we have one more class coming. But then know if there is a cavity lesion, what all things you can expect in your examination. Next, coming to investigations. What would you like to do? First thing? You'd like to
chest X-rays.
Yes, good. So chest X-ray of this patient. Chest X-ray showed right upper lobe opacity was present. Okay. Following chest X-ray, you did a CT scan and that revealed this. This was present in right upper lobe.
It's a homogeneous opacity.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So this patient had these things, no? So what they did is they just put him on antibiotics, okay? Since previous history of TB was present, suspecting to be a cavity lesion, secondary superficial infection, they put him on antibiotics, they did conservative management and they sent him, okay? Again, after 15 days, patient came back, he was doing fine for a week. Again, after 15 days, he came with similar complaints, okay? Now with moderate amount of hemoptysis has come. So this was
an abscess. Abscess, sir.
Now you're considering lung abscess. Okay, no. Okay, now you're considering lung abscess to be a differential diagnosis. Good, but sputum analysis was fine in this patient. Okay. Sputum analysis for Gram stain did not reveal anything.
Then,
in what other investigation you would like to do?
For tuberculosis.
Yes, okay. CBNAT, they sent the sputum for, that came out to be negative. Acid for staining also turned out to be negative.
Then bronchoscopy.
Okay, bronchoscopy they did. So CT scan they did. So what was the approach? It is a case of moderate hemoptysis. Okay, so CT scan did not you with CT scan you got that. So you went again ahead and you did the bronchoscopy. No.
Yes.
So bronchoscopy did not reveal anything much. Okay.
Okay. So still we have to find
but the still cause. There was bleeding, so they went and ahead and did bronchial artery embolization for this patient. Okay, even on doing bronchial artery embolization, okay, fine, that thinking in terms of fungal, very good. So you will like to do a GMS staining, no, either of sputum or a bile specimen?
Yes.
So you did, you consider CBNAT, but you forgot about GMS staining. Okay.
Okay,
but this patient even GMS turned out to be negative. But I'll tell next what happened. They did bronchial artery embolization. Okay.
Yes.
So this bronchial artery embolization, even on doing this bronchial artery embolization, bleeding was not controlled. So next, what you would like to do?
Surgery.
Yes. Good. So they went ahead and resected that part of the lobe. Okay. Bound by doing surgery. Okay. Yes. On resection, they sent it to staining, gram staining, acid phosph staining, for doing histopathology, all those things they did. Okay, and they got this. What is this? This is again GMS.
Aspergillum.
Yes, good, good. What?
Aspergillum.
Fungal hyphae, acute angle branching. What is this? This was a case of pulmonary aspergillosis, correct? No. So previously, yes, he had a cavitated lesion because of TB. Now what happened? A fungal ball formation was there, correct? No. See,
okay,
this was a fungal ball. Okay. But on, yes, doing bile, it so happened that GMS staining did not reveal anything. That's why they went ahead and did the surgery. On doing histopathology examination, they got this. Okay, pulmonary aspergilloma was present. So in this case, surgery was the modality of treatment. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. So,
sir, but why didn't it reveal in the BAL and the
not every time it will reveal, no? Like even, okay, not necessarily that a TB patient on sending first sample of CBNAT, it reveals, no?
Okay, sir.
It would have escaped. Huh?
Okay.
What was the reason for improvement on antibiotics? There might have been a superficial bacterial infection also, small amount of infection, so improved for some amount of time, or because of the conservative management he was put on hospital, he was managed, he would have improved a bit symptomatically, again he came back. So that's all to do with cough and hemoptysis. Hope it is clear. Anything else, any doubts? Rishabh, thank you. Anything else? Yes, we could have checked for HIV also. This patient, they did check for HIV because since he's been had, he was a driver, he had history of TB, they thought to be an immunocompromised state and they did HIV. It was negative, but okay. Can we consider sarcoidosis? Sarcoidosis, there would have been perihilar lymphadenopathy, no? And there wouldn't have been productive cough if it was sarcoidosis. There it would have been chronic history of dry cough. On doing chest X-ray, you could have had that perihilar lymphadenopathy. You would have had other systemic symptoms also. So any other doubts regarding today's class? Hope it was clear. Important, very important topic, hemoptysis, for your entrance exam and your Viva also. So, yes, we can end the session. Thank you, guys. Okay, let's see if time permits, we'll have further sessions. Since RS cough and hemoptysis is done, we'll see next session we can take up dyspnea if time permits. So, thank you. Have a good evening. Bye bye. And do attend the next session also.